thank you, Sayyid, for the translation and Noor for the recitation.
Thanks, man.
So, as I'm sure many of you all know, today's talk will be centered around the life of Prophet Yousuf alayhi salam, and it's one of the most detailed stories in the Quran, both involving human weaknesses such as jealousy, hatred, pride, deception, as well as noble qualities such as patience, loyalty, bravery, nobility. So before we get into this, I'd just like to introduce our speaker for tonight. So the man I'm introducing to you, he's an American Muslim scholar based out of Washington, D.C. He was born as William Webb in 1973 in Oklahoma to a Christian family, including a grandfather who served as a preacher. At age 14, he lost interest in religion, going through a self-described spiritual crisis. And after converting to Islam in 1992,
I'm going through a crisis right now.
After converting to Islam in 1992, Webb left his career as a DJ and studied at the University of Central Oklahoma, where he earned his degree in education. He also studied privately under a Senegalese sheikh, learning enough Islam and Arabic to become a community leader in Oklahoma City, where he was hired as imam at the Islamic Society of Greater Oklahoma City. Now, moving forward, this man has also spent several years in Egypt, graduating from Upper University from the College of Sharia, where he focused on Islamic law and jurisprudence. And after graduating, he moved to Santa Clara in the San Francisco Bay Area, where he worked with the Bay Area Muslim American Society Office and Muslim Community Association. And on December 1st, 2011, Webb was inaugurated as the imam of the Islamic Society of Boston's Cultural Center, the largest Islamic center in New England. He's had over 60 years of experience by serving various communities in North America, and is currently managing an institute for training American imams in the Washington, D.C. area where he currently resides. He's a strong advocate for grassroots Muslim activism to promote social change. And if we're talking accolades, he was named as one of the 500 most influential Muslims by the Royal Islamic Strategic Studies Center. His website, suhaibweb.com, was voted the best blog of the year by the 2009 Brass Crescent Awards. His tweets won him the vote of Best Muslim Tweeter of 2010. So, brothers and sisters, without further ado, it is our honor to introduce you all to Imam Suhaib Webb.
Bismillah ar-Rahman ar-Rahim, alhamdulillah, salatu wassalam ala Sayyidina Muhammad, Sayyid al-Awwaleen wal-Akhireen, ala alihi wa sahbihi ajma'een. I don't know if you can hear me, so just have to let me know. Just a lot of microphones. Khalid, you've gotten more like complex over the years, you know. It's bigger budgets, more complexities. MashaAllah, it's great to be back in New York on Halloween, alhamdulillah. After spending 3 days in New Jersey. Sorry, I realize how that sounds now. But it's great to be in New York after being in a different area of America. It's great to be here at the ICNYU with Brother Khalid, his family, as well as many of you who I've known for a number of years, have a really interesting relationship with New York City, going back to the 90s. Some tremendous friends and leaders, such as Imam Siraj Wahaj, Imam Abdul Malik, who maybe some of you know, who's now in Orlando, Imam Talib in Harlem, and other, you know, personal acquaintances and friends. And it's great that we're, you know, when I was told the topic, initially I was told like in, I think it was May, that there's like some kind of Halloween party or something happening. So then I figured it was just like the Halloween, like, you know, runs parallel to a Halloween type thing. And then just a few days ago, I was told that the topic had changed and that people wanted to spend some time with scripture, with the Quran, and that actually really pleased me because I believe that Quranic literacy is one of the key components of a Muslim personality, regardless of if they are an imam or a student, a parent, whatever. Each and every one of us has a responsibility in having a relationship with the Quran. And then, alhamdulillah, I was given a copy of this. I'm sure you've probably heard about it. This is the Study Quran This is the bootleg version that I bought in Spanish Harlem around 2 o'clock in the afternoon today. You can't find this anywhere else, no. Actually, which will be released on the 17th of November, was translated by Dr. Syed Hussein Nasser, who, of course, is in the D.C. area, and worked on by 11 editors. One of them is Joseph Lombard, who is at Brandeis University, Sheikh Shaker, his name is Shaker, and also Maria Dakaki, who also is a very respected professor, and Muhammad Rustam, and a number of people who put 10 years into this translation to render it into English for English speakers. And then what makes it absolutely incredible is there's no Arabic in it, so the bottom of it is primarily just based on really authentic explanations of Quran that are not going to give you all of the answers, but are going to inspire you to do further research, but kind of tell you, hey, go look here, or go read this, or look for this article, or read this tafsir. And as a community, Sheikh Hamza has said that this translation is perhaps one of the most historical moments for the English-speaking Muslim community. And I encourage you, I know in D.C. we are actually doing a launch of it on the 24th at Busboys and Poets, which is kind of like this hipster restaurant by Howard University, to celebrate the Quran and to own it as a community. You know, Allah says in Surah Yunus, وَبِذَلِكَ فَلْيَفْرَحُ. Allah says we should celebrate the Quran. And coming out on Amazon and actually being advertised by Amazon, I would encourage you to write a review on Amazon and to rate it, because definitely the Islamophobes have already started to really hunt this translation down and try to discredit it. And you find now affluent Muslims, alhamdulillah, making donations to their universities where they are alumni and donating like, you know, 300 or 400 copies of this to their Middle Eastern studies departments as well as their libraries. And that's the kind of like reception the Quran deserves. The Quran deserves an excitement and a passion that sometimes we lack because of language and also because of context. So I was really happy to hear that you wanted to spend some time. I was assuming that I have a sense of humor. If you don't know me, don't freak out. But I was assuming it was like 2 or 3 verses, but then I was told it's the whole surah in an hour and a half. So what I plan to do is, number one, to talk about what are the rights the Quran has on us. You know, we all of us have the responsibility of having an individual relationship with Quran. One of the things I find unique is when I talk to people who are born Muslims, is they ask me like, you know, am I worthy of speaking on their behalf? Are they worthy of approaching the Quran? Are they good enough, if you will, to have a relationship with the book of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala? And this is actually one of the tricks of Satan. So my response to them is that at the age of 17, my friend and I, he was Muslim, I was producing music for him, and we were smoking copious amounts of marijuana. And it was in those moments that we actually started to talk about Islam. And I'm not encouraging, I'm just saying this is how it happened. And then, but in Jannah, inshallah, it's another story. But it's Jannah, I can do what I want. So I found a copy of Quran actually in the studio where I was producing gangster rap music and DJing for groups like Cocaine Crew and Mafia Style and AK Assault. You know, like, these are really, you know, carriers of piety. But it was in the studio that I started to read the Quran. And then I took it, I stole it. So then I stole the Quran. I was like, Duriyatu biha matharat miqdariha. It's like an axiom, you can do what you, like eating pork, you know, you're gonna die. So I stole the Quran and, sounds wrong. And then I put it in the restroom of my mother's house because I wasn't Muslim, relax, man, don't get it twisted. And I was 17, right? And I started to read the Quran because I was scared that my mother would, you know, eviscerate me if she found it. My mother's a Christian woman from the country, right? My mother was raised on a farm. So she's a Church of Christ, and Church of Christ people are very literal. Like, we didn't wear shorts. I couldn't listen to music. It was hardcore. We ate at home. We didn't eat outside. And I found Islam in that situation is the point I'm trying to make. So, like, if I found spiritual compassing and the ability to increase my spiritual capacity, being inebriated, making gangster rap music, as well as like death metal, and doing so in a restroom in the house of a staunch Christian woman. I'm sure if you were already born Muslim, you have the ability. And that's why one of my teachers used to say in Masr, Nurun ala nur hul Muslim ma al Quran. He say that when Allah says in the 24th chapter of the Quran, like light upon light, he was like, that's a Muslim who reads the Quran. Because a Muslim already has light. So when they recite the Quran, liyazdada alladhina amanu imana, Allah increases their faith. And I feel sometimes as a community, we intimidate people, man. We're so intimidated about revelation and religion that it actually works against really what the Quran is trying to do. The Quran is trying to inspire us to live a responsible life. That's why it's called Al-Wahi. So let's talk quickly. Imam Al-Muhasibi wrote this really amazing book called Risalatu Mustarshidin. We teach it in DC once a month, alhamdulillah. And Imam Zaid translated a very good translation called, you know, the Epistle for the Seekers of Guidance, you know, the letter to the one who's seeking God, maybe. If I was going to translate it in a little bit more of an ASAP Rocky type vernacular, I would say, you know, the epistle, the letter to the one who's lost and who's seeking a way out. And in that book, Al-Muhasibi says that the Quran has the following rights on each and every one of us. Before we start this, I thought it's important to say that. He says, وَعْلَمْ أَنَّ فَرِيدَةَ كِتَابُ اللَّهِ. He said, you know that the rights of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala's book upon you are the following. الْعَمَلُ بِحُكْمِهِ مِنَ النَّهِ وَالْأَمْرِ. He said, the first right that the Quran has is that you live it, that you practice it, right? That you act on its orders and prohibitions. You struggle. And what he means here, we'll talk about this as we get into Surah Yousuf. It doesn't mean perfection. It means that you make an attempt. You struggle. I struggle. You know, there was one companion of the Prophet, peace be upon him, who was one of the last companions to die in Iraq. He was one of the last three companions to die. And one day, his student came to him, and he said to him, why are you so happy? He said, today, I finished the Quran. He was like, what? Like, really? Like, but you've been Muslim for a hot minute. I mean, you've been Muslim for a while. Like, today? Like, aslamta aqib al-Badr. Like, you became Muslim after the Battle of Badr. Like, and you just finished it today? He's like, la, la, la. Ma khantamtuhu bil-aqwali, bal khatamtuhu bil-af'al. So he said in Arabic, he said, no, I didn't finish it, like, reciting it. I finished it with my deeds. I made khatam bil-fi'l. So he said, I don't understand. How do you finish the Quran with deeds? He said, when I became Muslim, I promised that I would try to act on the Quran. Like every prohibition or injunction, command, I would act on. So he said, it's kind of funny. He said, like, I finished 20 years ago, actually, but there was like one I couldn't get done. And he was like, which one is that? He was like, in Surah An-Nur, when you knock on someone's house and they're not home. He said, every time someone was home. I was like, I couldn't find someone at home, right? And Allah says, farji'u, so you know, if they don't answer, you should go back. So every time I went, someone was there, but today, alhamdulillah, no one was home. So he said, today, I finished the Quran. And there should be an attachment to Quran. That's why, you know, many ulama, they say, it's haram to joke with Quran, in the sense of like, to defile it. But they would say, if you are able to contextualize Quran in your life in a way that doesn't domesticate its transcendence, then even that's somewhat makruh, not haram, because it shows that you've digested the Quran. Abdullah bin Mubarak, he's a great scholar, you know, and he was a student of Imam Abu Hanifa, and he was like interesting person, very eclectic. And one day he got lost in the desert. Well, no, lost, sorry, he was traveling in the desert. Ibn Jawzi mentions this, and he found this woman. And he said to her, what happened to you? And then she said, ثُمَّ إِنَّكُمْ أَيُّهَا الضَّالُّونَ الْمُكَذِّبُونَ. She read this verse from Surah Al-Waqi'ah, which means, therefore, thereafter, you have been led astray, those who lie. So she was trying to tell him, someone tricked me, and now I'm lost in the desert. She answered with Qur'an. And Imam Abdullah bin Mubarak, he said to her, where are you going? She said, Rabbul Mashriqi, the Lord of the East. So he started getting confused, like, every time I ask a question, she has a Quran, man. So then he said, okay, where's your man at? Like, where's your husband? She said, Ya ayyuha alladhina amanu, la tas'alu an asha'in tubarakum tusukum. Oh, you who believe, don't ask about nefarious things that will corrupt you. So he was like, damn, okay, I got it. So then he said, you know, can I help you get to the place where you need to go? And she said, وَقَالُوا الْحَمْدُ لِلَّهِ الَّذِي هَدَانَا لِهَذَا وَمَا كُنَّا لِنَهْتَدِي. Praise be to Allah who guided us. If it wasn't for him, we wouldn't be guided. He started freaking out. He was like, stop it! It'd be a great children's play. This would be a great children's play. And he says, like, stop it! And then she's like, you know, لَوْ أَنزَلْنَا هَذَا الْقُرْآنَ عَلَى جَبَلٍ لَرَأَيْتُ. You know, if the Qur'an fell on a mountain, it would crush the mountain, right? And then he said, okay, just get on the camel. And then she gets on the camel and she sees him and she says, وَقُلْ لِلْمُؤْمِنِينِ يَغْضُونَ مِنْ أَبْصَارِهِمْ وَيَحْفَظُونَ فُرُوجَهُمْ. Tell the believing men to lower their gaze. He's like, what the heck? His memoir is very funny, the story. And then he said, of course, when she got on his camel, SubhanAllah, سَخَّرَ لَنَا هَذَا. So the whole time she just stopped Quran. And then finally they find this caravan. And she says, you know, it's actually the verse from Surah Yousuf. There's this caravan, that's the caravan I'm looking for. And then he said to her, like, who am I? Like, then he's in his memoir, he's like, I finally got her. So I was like, okay, who are you looking for? Yeah, that, I bet their name ain't in Quran. And she was like, وَوَهَبَنَا لَهُ إِسْحَاقَ وَيَعْقُوبُ. They had two boys, Ishaq and Yaqub. Like, I give up, man. I just give up. So he went, he found her sons. He brought them back to her, and as they approached, she said, "Hal ataka hadithu dayfi Ibrahim al-mukramin." She started reading the story of Ibrahim and how he took care of his guests, and so hook him up, feed him, and then he ate. She's like, "Kulu washrabu hani and bima kuntum asleftum." You know, eat and drink and be joyous. And then by this time, he's like, "Yo, man, this is, come on, man." So then he asked her children, who didn't speak Quran, spoke Arabic. He says to Ishaq and Yaqub, like, I ask you, man, like, your mom, you know what I'm saying? Like, I know I'm a scholar and everything, but, like she just talks Quran. And they were like, she's been like this for 40 years. Like, okay. But the point is how she's able to contextualize Quran into her life implies an intimacy, not just a literacy, but there's like an intimacy to that. Right, there's something tied into that. So the first thing he says is that we should act on it. We should have an intention to act on it. We should struggle to act on it. The second thing that Al-Muhasibi said is, he said, Al-Khawf wal-Raja. He said there should be fear and hope. There should be fear of what the Quran threatens. Right? And there should be hope in what it promises. And you know, we believe that our faith rests between two wings, fear and hope. Imam Ibn Qayyim said, fear and hope are like two wings on a bird, right? The third thing he said, اعتبار بقصصه وأمثاله, and that takes us to Surah Yusuf. He said the third thing is that there should be a attention and lessons drawn from its parables and its stories. And the last thing he said is that there should be faith in its allegorical verses. But one fourth of the equation that Muhasibi said, the rights of the Quran upon us, again, just to repeat them, to act on it. Number two is to have fear and hope with it. Number three is to give regard to its stories and lessons. And the fourth is to have faith in the allegorical verses like Alif Lam Mim and so on. That takes us to stories. Stories are extremely important, you know. And we learn so many things from stories. We learn inspiration, and also we learn the opposite of what we should live. We should inspire ourselves to be the opposite of sometimes evil characters. You know, the outcome of Harry Potter is a desire not to be the evil that we read in it. The outcome of, you know, for example, reading A Tale of Two Cities, to be the opposite. The outcome of reading any type of story, whether fiction or nonfiction, is inspiration and condemnation. And it creates capacity. So you find some of our early scholars would talk about stories, and it's really cool. They would say, for example, Imam Abu Hanifa, of all people, said, you know, حكايات الصالحين أحب إلي من كثرة الفقه. Abu Hanifa would say, like, the stories of pious people are more beloved to me than fiqh. and jurisprudence. So I asked him why. He said, because that really embodies the crux and the reality and the organics of submission, right? Stories tend to take us away from the idealized notions that we have. They cause us to come down to earth and appreciate the organics of life. Imam al-Junaid, he said, Hikayatu salihin junu min junurillah. Junaid said that the stories of the righteous are soldiers from God. Yuthabbitu Allah biha quluba awliya'i. Allah strengthens the hearts of people with them. And that's why you read sometimes about Surah Yousuf, you know. Surah Yousuf is incredible because of the context that it was sent in. And it's really a story about promise, right? A story about God's promise under extremely difficult odds. And that's why if we were to think of a theme for Surah Yousuf, maybe the theme would be loss and gain. Like you lose something, but you gain something. And battling like the seasons of this life and how it affects our hearts, like, you know, losing someone that we love or getting a promotion or, you know, a divorce or our children are losing their minds or I'm in college and I think this exam is like the single most important thing ever in my life and I blow it or I kill it, mashallah, metaphorically, and I'm just getting promoted and I keep moving and moving and moving. So under success and failure, loss and attainment, Yousuf holds it down. And that's very applicable to every single one of our lives, because life is not linear. It changes. And that's why Sayyidina Ali, Imam Ali, karramallahu wajhahu, he used to say, you know, la tafrah bil ghina. He used to say, don't get happy if you're rich. Wa la taqnat bil faqr. And don't become despondent if you're poor. What he means is like, just be with Allah. Whatever happens, life is going to come at you like waves. That's why the Arabs say, tamawujul fitna. Right? Hardships are like waves that hit you. You have to stay down. So Surah Yousuf is really about a lover who has to balance his love for all the things that we love. Wealth, fame, physical attraction, being respected, right? With his love for his Lord. And sometimes he has to sacrifice that for his Lord. And he does it. That's tough. Right? It's hard. I've been there. I know how hard it is. So the story is really a story of inspiration. And that's why one of the students of the Sahaba used to say, if you feel depressed, read Surah Yousuf. Keeping that as the theme, right? Let's talk about the context of when this chapter was sent. This chapter was sent in the 10th year in Mecca. You know what scholars of the Prophet's biography say? They see the single most difficult year in the entire 23-year life of the Prophet as a prophet is the 10th year. It's the most difficult year. He loses his wife, loss. Now you can appreciate Surah Yousuf. He loses his uncle, loss. Yousuf loses his brothers, man. We're going to talk about that later. He loses his wealth. The people of Mecca, they put a social boycott on the Prophet, sallallahu alaihi wasallam. Now sometimes being Muslim, I have a daughter, she's 12 years old, right? And when she comes to America, she lives with her mother in Malaysia. When she comes to America, she's like, I feel there's a different type of pressure in this country, you know, to be a Muslim woman. Within the community and with outside the community, right? So Yousuf has to face that pressure. The Prophet faces that pressure. Complete ostracization. Nobody even speaks to them. They take an oath of silence. You will not speak to the Muslims. The other thing is that Islam wasn't popular in Mecca. Like sometimes we read this really sanitized version of the seerah and it's like really happy and awesome. It's like the magic school bus or something. Like, wow, you know. But there were less than 65 Muslims in Mecca. Like it wasn't on Twitter. Like the Arabian Twitter wouldn't have been like number two, like hashtag Islam is cool. Like the opposite. So under those really difficult situations and the face of acute loss, Allah sends certain chapters to the Prophet's fledgling community to really teach them deeper lessons and to make them look into their emotional connections. So one of them is Surah Al-Kahf. We all like Surah Al-Kahf. And I'm sure we're all puzzled at the end of it, like, why did he kill that kid? Why you knock a hole in the boat? Right? Why would you build a wall for free? I mean, hook it up, get paid. Right? You read in the chapter, but it's telling you weird things happen, but Allah is wise. In Mecca, weird things are happening to you, but Allah is wise. In Mecca, people might have got it twisted, like, all these rich people are doing so well. We have nothing. Surah Al-Kahf. وَلَوْلَا إِذْ دَخَلْتَ جَنَّتَكَ قُلْتَ مَا شَاءَ اللَّهِ. Right? Allah talks about the man who has the nice garden, the guy whose garden is, Another chapter that's sent at that time to the Prophet's community is Surah Yasin. Reminds him of the hereafter, what really matters. And also Surah Yusuf. So inshallah, what we'll do is instead of reading the entire chapter, which I'm sure you can do on your own, what I've done is just divided it into some themes. We'll look at a few of the verses. We'll build on the themes. I don't think we'll be able to finish the whole chapter. And then instead of you asking questions, I want you to think about this differently. I believe in the model of a learning imam, a learning community, right? So not only, if you have a question, that's fine. Imam Khalid is here. He'll answer all the questions. But more so, what do you want to share and teach to people around you? What do you hear? You say, you know what? Well, Suhaib kind of missed that point. Well, share that, right? Share that with us. Teach, right? And ask and learn. So actually, the chapter starts very interestingly. It starts, of course, we all know, with a story. And it also starts with Alif Lam Ra. You know, most of the scholars say that these huruf muqatta'a, these, you know, broken letters, alif lam mim, ha mim, alif lam ra, alif lam sa, you know, and so on and so forth, sad. No one knows what their meaning is, except Allah. It's correct. But usually, if you look at the verse after these huruf muqatta'a, you find a verse that talks about the greatness of the Quran. So it's like, alif lam ra, tilka ayatul kitab al-mubin. So Allah says, Alif Lam Ra, Surah Yusuf, these are the verses of a book that makes things clear. Alif Lam Mim, Dharika al Kitabu La Rayba Fi. Surah Al-Baqarah, same thing. Alif Lam Mim, this is a book that has no doubt in it. So scholars usually said that these huruf muqatta'a, these broken letters, Alif Lam Mim, and so on, were used to show people no matter how much knowledge you attain, no matter how much success and spiritual insight you have, there are certain things in Quran that you'll never be able to grasp. And it's very important you think about what happens to Prophet Yusuf through the story. And then as we continue, Allah mentions that, you know, نَحْنُ نَقُصُّ عَلَيْكَ أَحْسَنَ الْقَصَصِ. Allah talks about how He sent the most beautiful story to the Prophet. This is the most detailed story in the Quran of any Prophet. But something happens at the bottom. What does Yusuf see? Okay, what was the dream? So I can drink some coffee. He saw إِنِّي رَأَيْتُ أَحَدَ عَشَرَ كَوْكَبًا. He saw 11 stars. And he saw what? The sun and the moon. Who does he talk to about this problem? قَالَ يَا أَبَتِي. No, he goes to his father. It's قَالَ يُوسُفُ لِي أَبِيهِ. He says to his father, يَا أَبَتِي. Oh, my father, I saw in this dream 11 stars, the sun and the moon. Here we take really two components for success. Number one is, because the story of Yusuf is really a story of identity in the face of constant change, maintaining a certain identity. The first is the power of the unseen. That as a young Muslim, as Muslims, we believe that there is a metaphysical reality. That metaphysical reality exists. And that's why Surah Al-Jinn also was sent at that time in Mecca to tell the Prophet, listen, if all of physical beings have turned away from you and rejected you, there are invisible beings who believe in you. Like, you're being supported. So Sayyidina Yusuf, he sees a dream. We know that the Prophet ﷺ said dreams are a fourth of prophethood. Another narration, he said a sixth of prophethood. What does that mean? That doesn't mean like tonight I see in my dream, you know, DJ Khaled is gonna give me some money. I just wanna say Imam Khaled so bad. Like he says it, the other guy, but I couldn't, I don't want to embarrass you. Because I don't think he even knows who that is. But let's say in my dream I see Imam Khalid, and it says like, yo, go to Imam Khalid, and Imam Khalid is gonna write you like a fat check. So next morning after Fajr, I go to Imam Khalid, I'm like, I saw a dream, right? And it's a portion of prophethood. Hook it up, right? Some people misunderstood what this hadith means actually is if we see a dream and then later on that dream comes true, then it's equated to a portion of prophethood. You understand? Like for example, we had this brother that I knew. We went with Jamaat Tabligh when we first converted. They kidnapped us. And we went and we saw a Malaysian community, and then I saw him making dua passionately at night. So I said, what are you? He said, please ask Allah to give me a Malaysian wife. I said, man, what were you looking at, man? We were making dawah. He's like, don't worry about it. But then, mashallah, he married a Malaysian woman. He told me I had a dream that I married a Malaysian woman. And I was like, are you sure that's not like a pickup line? You use the isna? Y'all don't know about me, do you? Yeah, so he said maybe. But the point is he did see this dream. And then, mashallah, it happened. So that's like part of prophethood. You understand now what that means? So Prophet Yusuf is shown a dream. He's brought into a metaphysical world. But then in order to manage the metaphysical world, he has to rely on the support group. And the support group here is his father. So one of the things that we should think about as we are young from the story of Yusuf and as we struggle. I mean, listen, I lived in San Francisco. I lived in St. Louis, Detroit. I lived in Qahira. I lived in Boston. I know you love Boston. And I lived in D.C. I have never seen a city as fast as New York City in my life. It's fast, man. It's fast. It moves quickly. So in order to really survive that speed, that current, right, I need to have some spirituality, but I also need to have some support group around me, someone I could help maintain my balance. So we see Yusuf has both. The beginning of the story, he has al-ghaybiyat, the unseen, his ru'ya, his dream. But he also has his father, grounds him and helps him stay focused. Now, after that, the story continues, and it's very interesting because after he tells his father that he sees 11 people and the sun and the moon prostrating to him, most of the scholars said that the stars are obviously his brother, but the sun and the moon are his parents. And they differ. Is the sun the mother or the father the mother? Those of you who are involved in gender studies, I respect you, I love you. Listen, don't get mad at me. I'm pro-choice on that issue. If you want to say the mother is the son, God bless you. If you want to say the father is the son, God bless you. I'm open to both interpretations, okay? But the point is that we, as students in New York City, or me as I live in Washington, D.C., I am reflective of the light I've received from my parents, from that peer group. So the idea that I'm alone now and I'm not responsible may not really hold water, because the outcome of having that severe support group is I have to be responsible in how I carry myself. So Sayyidina Yusuf and his brothers are reflecting the light that his parents, his mother and his father, gave him, mashallah. And for parents, that means that we are the sun and the moon of our children. Meaning that one of us, and this is why I believe both interpretations are proper, whichever one is more obedient to Allah will shine brighter. So that one becomes the sun. And the other one, who may be struggling with that double apple mint, is receiving that light from the other spouse, and then that light is radiated upon the children. But you can see the beauty of how parenthood is portrayed, and the support group is portrayed. We'll talk about that in a second. But after he tells his father that I saw these 11 stars and the sun and the moon prostrating to me, does his father say like, yeah, oh, okay, you're gonna be on Who's Who, and we're gonna like hook it up, we're gonna tell everybody you had this amazing dream, yes, my son, da-da-da-da-da. What does his father tell him? Don't tell people about it. But in particular, don't tell who? To tell your brothers. So here we learn a hard lesson. It's a tough lesson. You know, keep your, like in The Godfather, right? Your friends and your enemies, right? Sometimes you might got a lot of enemies, right? You know, watch it. I'll do it back to back too on you. But just because people may be close to us doesn't necessarily mean we should trust them. So his father is teaching him, yes, with success, you have to be strategic. Right? With success, you have to be strategic. فَيَكِيدُ لَكَ كَيْدًا. The word kid in Arabic means something bad. Like when I plan, أُكِيدُ لَكَ شَيْئًا means I plan to hurt you. Right? So he says, يَكِيدُ لَكَ كَيْدًا. That indeed, they will plot against you. So he's taught now the balance of life between the metaphysical and the physical, a support group, and then also to be strategic. To take precautions. You know, one of the things that the Quran constantly teaches us is to take precautions. Medical science tells us one of the most difficult experiences anyone can ever have is childbirth. And you've seen that YouTube clip, that guy from Sweden, where he's like, I want to feel how my wife felt. I'm like, that dude is crazy. I'll just let you tell me about it. Or read like Maya Angelou and like figure it out for myself. But I'm not trying to plug up to no earth-shattering, kidney-breaking, spine-busting experience. So I already love my wife enough. I don't need to do that. Right, brothers? Exactly. So this guy, brothers like, look at their wife. Can I say okay? Can I have permission? I'm gonna get y'all in trouble. So they hook him up and he like basically in 2.5 seconds basically loses it. Right. Medical science has the most difficult pain we can experience is childbirth. Women experience the childbirth. Human beings. Look at Sayyidina Maryam. She's having a baby and Allah says, وَخُذِي إِلَيْكَ بِجِذْعِ النَّخْلَ. Allah says, even though you're experiencing labor, grab that big freaking date tree and pull it over to you and shake it. Yeah, how many of you had a baby? Anyone here? What would you do if your doctor told you, grab a date tree and shake it? I'm calling my healthcare provider. Like, where's Yelp? Give me -1. Shoot, the doctor's crazy. Right? But our scholars say, even though she couldn't do it, Allah is teaching us that we have to take precautions. We have to make effort. Right? So he's telling his son, be careful with blessings. And that's why sometimes my teacher, when I was memorizing the Quran, he used to tell me, don't tell people you memorized. Right? He's like, especially Surah Baqarah. Don't tell people. Like, some things you need to keep secret. But that doesn't mean, and we'll talk about it later, that we become like, you know, social Neanderthals and, you know, social derelicts. We should also celebrate the graces of Allah, but strategically. And then Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says that inna shaytan, indeed shaytan is adu mubin, to humanity is an enemy. Meaning that, and here's something really cool, it's not your brothers that are going to freak out on you, but shaytan's going to mess with your brothers. So this is where we see how Yusuf is able to keep it just. Later on in the story, he forgives his brothers. Anta Yusuf, they ask him, are you Yusuf? He says, I'm your brother. He forgives them. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is saying, listen, don't hate them. Understand that shaitan is going to mess with them and change them. And that takes us to something very important. Shaitan. Shaitan basically has 7 strategies for all of us. We should know these well. I wrote it as a poem one time when I was in Azhar. No disrespect to Egyptians. I love you. We cool. I get it. But sometimes the lecture was extremely boring. MashaAllah. I'm sure that never happens here. So I would start to doze off in class. However, if you fall asleep in a class in Egypt, you have basically made yourself eligible to lose any semblance of your human dignity. So basically, don't fall asleep. So I wrote this poem because I read this book about the tricks of shaitan, and he has 7. Saba'atun 'allamani Ibn Qayyim. I wrote it. It said 7 things which Ibn Qayyim mentions that shaitan tries to do to us. First is to make us disbelievers. And it does that through 2 means, doubts and desires. I mean, there are grown-up people right now in this city. I'm talking about 43-year-old men dressed like Pan. I'm serious, they're dressed like Peter Pan. And they're not with their kids. I'm not making fun of anybody, but it's just strange. It's a grown man dressed like Peter Pan, right? And Christopher Robin, you know what I'm saying? How old are you? 46. Like, where's your kids at? Oh, I don't have no kids. So what I'm saying is like, sorry. I'm laughing with them in all of their panness, okay? I'm not laughing at them. Astaghfirullah. So, you okay, bro? Brother let it out right there. Maybe he has the pantsuit at the crib, you know? He's like, I wish he'd hurry. My pixie dust out. But two means by which Shaitan takes us out to disbelief. One is doubt and desires, right? So dressing up like Pan may fall under both. I don't know. But doubt is remedied, and our scholar said, doubt is remedied by questions, asking. You should have access to imams. You should demand, right? You're going to have disposable income soon. You're coming from NYU. That is a driver's license to get a job, basically, mashallah, wherever you want, okay? At least that's what they say about it when they charge you all those fees. But the point is, if I'm donating to a 501c3, I am going to make some suggestions nicely. I'm not going to be Tony Soprano or Tony Montana and walk in and start shooting board members. No, but I'm going to say, listen, I'm writing a check. I don't want my daughter praying behind a wall. Okay? I'm writing a check. I would appreciate it if there was like an actual functional, like say, a charter and like, you know, SOPs and a strategic vision. And we all know that strategic vision and we work as a community for that strategic vision. It would be great if it was audited twice a year, externally and internally. Like, I'll pay for that. Like, I'll hook you up. I'll write a fat check for that. Right? But I'm not going to write a fat check if we're going to argue over what kind of asphalt we're going to use and which contractor is going to get the contract to lay the asphalt. I'm not donating to that. And one of the things that I will donate to is that every community member has an access to scholarship. People should be able to ask questions of imams. When I take a job as an imam anywhere, and I'm not looking right now, but when I do, I lay down two conditions. Number one, I am not a counselor. I need counseling. I'm not going to be giving counseling. You understand what I'm saying? Like, I don't want to be like meeting with people and trying to help them solve their marriages. And like, you know, so we brought in Boston clinicians on campus to do that, right? Because then you're freed up to teach. You're freed up to ask questions. All of us, I remember as a convert, I would go to the office of the imam and he's like, Ana mashghul, al-huquq kathira. I'm busy. I said, what are you busy with? Well, see, this brother, his wife threw the muluhi at him last night and, you know, I had to go to their house. I'm like, but that's not why you studied. That's not what you do. Your job is to teach me and teach others. So there has to be access to knowledge. So the first one is the ability to deal with doubts is by asking questions in a safe place where you don't have to worry about it turning up in the masjid newsletter that Friday. The second thing is desires. Desires will deceive us. Right? Desires are the best muftis. They can help us find our way out of any situation and justify anything. So the first is to make us disbelievers. The second is to get us to fall into innovation. Bid'ah. The third is to make us fall into the major sins, like major haram. If you can't do that, then it's minor sins. If Shaitan can't do that, then it's the disliked. And if he can't do that, it's to get us to waste our time on the permissible. People ask, how do we waste our time on the permissible? I had this roommate in college. He's a really cool guy from Karachi, man. He's awesome. Mashallah. We used to eat aloo paratha like every day, right? With achar, who's such a cool brother. But he loved video games, man. Like, there's like, I like video games, and then there's like, intervention. Like, he's an intervention. So I remember it was Ramadan and the last 10 nights and the first Halo came out. So now you know how old I am. The first Halo came out and this brother lost his mind. This is the last 10 days of Ramadan and he told me like, I'm going to solve this game or whatever. I'm not into Halo. So I said, really? He said, yeah. I said, but it's the last 10 nights. He's like, well, you know, I gotta, right? So he actually was about to like spend all his time playing Halo, where it's like last 10 nights of Ramadan, you know, maybe something better you could be doing than playing video games. That's like wasting. But then he told me it's permissible, right? It's permissible, right? It's permissible, no doubt, But it's one of the tricks of shaitan to get us to waste our time on the permissible. The next is to get us to choose the lesser of two good. So I have two good things in front of me, I choose the lesser of two. And then the last is an all-out assault. Talk about that in the future. Don't ask me about it now. But an all-out assault is found in the story of Sayyidina Ayyub. Right? Again, so I'll mention the strategies of shaitan. Here is mentioned in the shaitan lil insani aduwwun mubin. Shaitan is an enemy to you. The first is what? Kufr. Second, innovation. Third, major sins. Fourth, minor sins. Fifth, the disliked. The sixth, the permissible. And the seventh is muharaba. Now the story continues, and we know that his brothers become aware of certain blessings that Sayyidina Yusuf has, and they begin to become jealous of him. Al-hasad is a little bit different than just jealousy, it's envy. Hasad means that I wish you didn't have it, and I wish I had it. And I question, why did God give it to you instead of me? This is what the meaning of hasad is. When we say, وَمِنْ شَرِي حَسِدٍ إِذَا حَسَدٍ. And the ulama said there are three remedies for that envy. Number one is to pray for the person I'm envious of. I should pray for them. Number two is to speak well of them. So people bring it up, like say I'm really jealous of DJ Khaled, right? And I'm like, well, you know, like that thing he wore with the Pope, you know, it was a little too white, dude. Right? Like, that's like, I'm not being serious. Right, but that's like that passive aggressive, because it was clean, mashallah. But like, that's like passive aggressiveness that I'm using to like knock him down, right? And then the third thing is, they said, is you should give them gifts, right? You should give them things, like you should be good to them. And that's how you deal with that envy that's in the heart, right? The story continues, and we know that his brothers, they tricked his father, and they encouraged him to let Sayyidina Yusuf go with them. Yarta wa yal'ab. He said he can play, he can relax. Da 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 da. And their brother said, I'm scared. Their father says, I'm scared that kuluhu dhib. I'm scared that a wolf will eat him. They reassure their father. And of course he lets him go, and we know what happens. They fake his death. They throw him in a well. There's actually a conversation amongst themselves. Should we kill him or should we not kill him? They throw him in the well and they leave him. Now, here's the other lesson we want to take from the story. How many of you ever gone to like a conference and there's like either a topic about youth, right? First of all, someone called me a youth the other day. I'm like, man, this is getting out of hand, man. Like, youth is like 13 and down, okay? But there's a discussion for younger community members or families. And you go in there, and like, the topic is like, how to have the perfect marriage. Or how to raise the perfect child, right? Or if you're young, like, how to become the perfect youth. You know what I'm talking about? And you keep hearing about things that maybe, as a human being, are very normal to be doing. And you get this idea that, like, the idea of family, it's perfect. Hence we see young Muslims, it's difficult to get married in the Muslim community, man. Like, for real. It's not just difficult because parents say no, but like, people are difficult. Like, some of the things that people ask me to find for them, I'm like, I can't find Matt Damon, who be praying to Hajj 24/7 and works for a hedge fund. Like, that dude don't exist. And his sister's like, well, off to the Zawiya. Or the brother, you know, I can't find the Eva Mendez in niqab, dude. I can't. Right? Ariana Grande. I don't know where that is. I don't objectify our sisters like that. What's wrong with you, man? And she has to speak like, you know, Gujarati. And she's Latina. I'm like, how's she going to be Latina that speaks Gujarati? Like, what do you want? Right? It becomes really irrational. And it's great to have high expectations and want that six pack. I get that. I understand it. But sometimes write down really what you're looking for, and you're going to be like, oh my God, what's wrong with me? Right? But we learned something from this story about family, and I really believe that's why today we had a very powerful discussion with our convert community. I call them the acceptors. Like, I wrote it down. So I accepted Islam. I like that better. You know, they've accepted faith, right? And that is that family is not utopic. It's not. And you see this here in the story. So let's look at the families in Quran and compare it to the families that we hear about sometimes in discussions. Right? Like, I remember I was at this one thing, and they were like, and there was this man, كَانَ رَجُلًا صَالِحًا. There was this man who was righteous, and he used to pray on one leg for 42 years. Why would you pray in one leg for 42 years? Like because he was so solid, he prayed on one leg. And fiqh, that's not even allowed. If you have two legs, you have to pray on them. So I was like, come on, brah. Who's the first family in the Quran? Who's the first story? Oh, there's a normal family. Imagine if you came to Isna with that problem. Sheikh, last night my son was barbecuing. And his brother got jealous and basically eviscerated him. What should I do? Sheikh, the chicken was good though. Right. What's the second family in Quran? Nuh, yes. Oh, there is a normal family. إِنَّهُ لَيْسَ مِنْ أَهْلِكَ إِنَّهُ عَمَنُ غَيْرُ الصَّالِحِ. Allah says, he's not your son. I mean, imagine hearing that, man. He's not your son anymore. Son drowns, doesn't listen to his father. So the third family is who? Sayyidina Ibrahim, normal family. Son, I'm going to throw you in some fire. Son, I'm going to slaughter you tomorrow. I saw in a dream, it was all a dream. Oh, okay, dad. Imagine you went to Isna. My father said he had this epiphany, and tonight when I go home, right? After Sayyidina Ibrahim, what's the family? Sayyidina Yusuf alayhi salatu salam. I mean, imagine if you're at a conference, Ikna, Mass, Isna. I'm not making fun of the conference, I'm just saying that's where we all gather, right? We have these questions, and someone raised their hand. So last night, we got mad at my little brother. So we bumped that dude on Craigslist and trying to sell that cat. That's what happened to Sayyidina Yusuf. After that, who? Musa. Oh, there's a regular family for you. You're raised in the house of your enemy. Right? Your surrogate is the guy who's oppressing your people. Right? And you have to keep it cool. And then you continue. Maryam. Yeah, that's a normal family. I'm pregnant. I ain't got no man. That's like some stuff on TV nowadays. Seriously. Pregnant with no man. Find out later. Seriously, I'm not making fun of her. I'm saying, and the reason I'm talking to you like this and people who get insecure and worried about it, I know you're probably gonna write a blog post about me. I get it, I don't mind. But listen, if you don't speak in a language we can relate to and understand, it's gonna be hard to grasp these things. But really, that's how it was received. Look at their reaction. So to Maryam, they're like, you are pregnant? And she's like, lemyam sasni bashar, no man touch me. In Arabic, that's the feeling. You lose the translation, it's like, no man touch me. But in Arabic, it's like, لَمْ أَكُنْ بَغِيًّا وَلَمْ يَمْسَسْنِي بَشَرٍ. Means like, I don't mess with dudes, and no dude even touch me. Like, that's the emotional feeling of it, right? That's a normal situation. So you look at all of the stories of families in the Quran, it is anything but utopic, and anything but normal, and these are the families of prophets. So then what about our families? Perhaps, you know, one sister came to me and she was telling me, like, I converted 25 years ago and I had all these expectations. I was going to be this. I was going to be like the reformer of Islam. And, you know, I was going to solve the European Union crisis and fix the currency in Malaysia. And I was like, wait, hold on, man, stop. And I said, you know, probably the answer to what you're going through is in the fact that you need to embrace your vulnerabilities. Like, you should address them instead of running from them, using utopia as a way to escape it and live in a different place. Like, Islam is telling us, look, these are the greatest families, but they had issues. So you shouldn't get it twisted. So Sayyidina Yusuf, his brothers turn against him, and they sell him, and he's sold for a paltry price. Allah says, bithamanin bakhs, you know, which means like nothing. They considered him of no value. They had no concern for him. But throughout this part of the Quran, Allah says, وَكَذَٰلِكَ وَكَذَٰلِكَ and thus we taught him the meanings of things. And thus we explained things to him. You know, what I understand from that is we learn a lot through hardship. We learn a lot through pain. We learn a lot through suffering. Have this trainer in Washington, D.C. This dude is crazy. And I think he could be in the movie Saw without any prep. So we're doing this exercise, the interval training thing, and he's like, after that, after you do this with the kettlebell like 500 times, you're gonna go on the treadmill, and you're gonna run for like 5 minutes as fast as you can. Then you're gonna come back and do a plank, and you're gonna do this thing with a kettlebell 500 times. You go back on the treadmill. I'm like, man, do you do like every day? Like, do you do this to yourself? Like, where's the nachos and pizza? Like, where's the hot Cheetos and strawberry pop, dude? Like, this is crazy. So then I go on the treadmill, right? I think I'm slick. I'm like normal speed, you know, like the natural speed of the treadmill. I'm like, I'm faking it. You know what I'm saying? Because stuff for a lot. You know, some people don't like to run on treadmills. This guy comes up behind me and turns the treadmill up on 355 miles an hour with an incline of Kilimanjaro. Seriously. And I turn to him and I'm like, man, why you do that? And he says to me, studies show that the harder the workout, the better you work out. He's dead serious, and it's true. So sometimes it's through hardship and difficulty, because we keep seeing Yusuf go through really tremendous difficulty. He loses his brothers, he loses his family, his father loses him, he's sold for a paltry price, he's debased, he's dishonored, and all of that, God says, we're teaching you something. So maybe now in our lives, we're going through hardship. It's, you know, one of the things we did in Boston, we surveyed our student population in Boston. Boston has the highest suicide ratio among 17 to 25-year-olds in America. No coincidence, it's the academic hub of America. Right, the amount of pressure on undergrads there is unbelievable. Graduate students, we know, you know what I'm saying. But undergrads, it's no joke. And we did a survey as a mosque of, like, what are your immediate needs? And the two most prominent responses we got were loneliness and making sense of life. Like, you would think if you got into Harvard, you're good. If you got into MIT, you're good, right? Straight, Northeastern, you're good. Making sense of life and loneliness. We see here, Yusuf, he goes through two, loneliness, and he goes through difficult challenges that would sway anybody. But Allah keeps saying, through this hardship, through these difficulties, I need you to pay attention. This is really cool. I appreciate you staying attentive this long. Through these difficulties and through these hardships, we teach you things. We teach you things. Now, that's why in Arabic, we talk about faith. We say iman billah. The word bat in Arabic is an article preposition. It implies haraka. It implies movement. So like if I walked in the room with Khalid, right? Imam Khalid, I would say jittu bi Imam Khalid. I came with him, right? When you say bismillah, you usually say bismillah when we're doing something. Like I lay down, bismillah. I get up, bismillah. I walk, bismillah. I eat, bismillah. Bismillah is brought into the context of action. So we say I have faith, billah, implying that my faith is with me and it moves with me. You lose this in English. English is black and white, right? Arabic is like HD, right? You get these little subtleties like what? It's like chicken tikka masala at the crib and chicken tikka masala outside. It's good. It's a little greasy. But at home, chicken cry is to cry for. You know what I mean? It's a Pakistani dish if you haven't had it. Wow, right? Don't tell your trainer though. But iman billah, the word ba means with. So my life, my hardships, my difficulties, the successes, everything I've achieved, the hardship, the lowest of the lows, the greatest of the greats, billah is with Allah. Like faith is my boy. Faith got my back. That's the feeling of it. So even the Prophet says, "An tu'mina billahi," it means through all seasons. So Sayyidina Yusuf is going through it, hardship, difficulty. He gets purchased. Something happens to him. It's hard to fathom. Why is that happening? It's okay to ask sometimes why things happen. People say, "Oh my God, I shouldn't ask why things happen." But you are anyways. Your heart is asking, and why don't you ask? Right? But the answer or the solution is something that sometimes is hard to stomach, hard to take. but he keeps his identity. He sold, we know that he sold to someone, and then eventually, I'm going to have to summarize because of time, he falls into the hands of someone named Aziz. And some scholars say his name wasn't Aziz, he was just referred to as Aziz in Quran, like someone who's strong and mighty. And we know finally, hey, things working out for you now, like in this nice plush house, you got kind of an easy job, everything's working out for you, everything's cool, and then we know he runs into some challenges. And that is that the man's wife was interested in him, she wanted to seduce him. And what we understand also from the Quran is that Yusuf himself would have slipped لَوْلَا رَأَى بُرْهَانَ رَبِّي unless Allah strengthened him. Unless Allah strengthened him. But that's an incredible challenge, right? And here's something you can see from the story so far. He faces material challenges and he faces metaphysical challenges. He faces the enmity of his brothers, the salacious behavior of this woman, and then his own soul now is challenging him. And Allah says, if he had not seen the proof of God, he would have slipped. So you can appreciate now as a young person where he's coming from. Material challenges and spiritual challenges. But he keeps it. He struggles. He tries hard. He grinds. He spiritually grinds it out. So it's part of life, right? Loss, success. I remember, man, basically, not to scare you, but from 23 to 27, you're probably going to be perennially broke simply because of student loans and the fact that in college, we bought all kind of crazy cool stuff, right? It's just being in college. And it still happens even at the age of 40. I remember, but then like 30, 31, 32, you start balling, man. You start collecting them dead presidents, you know what I mean? It's like you got a little Smithsonian in your bank account. And you're like, and it's that like time of life where you like look at your bank account like six times a day and you're like, mashallah, wow, I got $5,000 in my checking account. Like, so awesome. There's no minus sign there. So happy, right? $5,000. And you're like, okay. But then as you start to clock it. You know, you start to make some dough. And I remember the first time this happened to me, I made a good amount of money, and then I got a message from the IRS. And all that money was gone within a month. And I said to myself, man, Allah can give and take. Times just come at you, and it reminds you that you are not in control. And one of the lessons we take from the story is that everything that's happening to him is to remind us that God is stable. But this world, whether it's poverty, whether it's success, whether it's, you know, the things that we might desire, whether it's the acclimation of wealth, is fragile. So he gets in this incredible position. We know that he refrains from being seduced by this woman. And then we know that a group of women plot against her and him. And he has to make a choice. And, you know, the choice of Yusuf is absolutely remarkable because choices are going to always come up. Every single day we make choices. Every single day we make choices. But he makes a big choice. And that choice really is a powerful metaphor for our whole life. Just like Ismail, the slaughter of Ismail is a metaphor. Every one of us has an Ismail we have to slaughter, metaphorically. And everyone has a choice that Yusuf made almost every day, metaphorically, to make. But what does he do? He says, Rabbi sijnu ahabbu ilayya mimma yadu'unani. Oh Allah, prison is more beloved to me. And we know that the Prophet said the prison, that this dunya is a prison for a believer and a jannah for a disbeliever. He chooses that. He makes that choice. And he finds himself low again. And here's something interesting about the story that many people may miss. In his greatest moments of emotional isolation and being physically deprived, the richness of his soul is developed and the capacity of his heart is expanded. And that's why sometimes, you know, we go through really difficult times, man. Hard moments. You know, the Boston bombing for me, no, I should write a book about that. I mean, imagine that, right? I don't care what people say about me. Like, if I can't be honest about my life with you, how are you going to be honest about your life with me? If we don't trust each other to be honest, let's just be honest. Let's just be real. Ain't got no money. I got kids. That's how I know about all those songs, I swear to God. But imagine, I'm going through the Boston bombing. Islamophobes are attacking me like a wounded cow in the Amazon bleeding out by piranhas. Like everything about me, they're like, he has blonde hair because he's trying to trick us. Like, I'm born blonde hair, man. What the heck, man? Those blue eyes are like contact lenses. Like, man, what? They're insane, right? And I have press in front of my house. Press in front of my house. I leave my house. Imam, did you know the Sarnaya brothers? I was like, I don't know. Who are they? I don't know. I didn't know at that time even who was who. Right? You try to go to the mosque, you can't function, and then you have personal challenges. But subhanAllah, when I look back in that moment, my salah was so meaningful to me. And my dua had such meaning because I'm like, help me. This is no freaking joke, man. That's when you're making, when you're saying that in dua, you know it's like real. You know, usually it's like, Bismillah, Alhamdulillah, wa sallam, Rabbana atina fid dunya hasana. But when you're like, please, whatever I gotta do, I'm about to crack. This stuff is no joke. I can't handle it. I know I'm not supposed to talk to you like this, but I'm in pain. Help me, right? That's really where we find, when we reflect in our lives and back into our lives, tremendous capacity to do things later on. So I remember after the Boston bombing, I was invited to an institution to do some consulting. I walked into this boardroom, and wallahi, these brothers were going at it. They were like physically fighting, right? And my whole thing in talking to them was, how can we create a more dynamic board? So imagine, like, they're already fighting, right? So I walk in, and mashallah, I killed it. I dropped the mic. You know what I mean? And afterwards, they were like, thank you, brother. They even gave me an extra check. I was like, dang, dude, keep fighting. Like, keep having problems, right? You know what? I think there's another problem here. Let me aggravate this for you. But then I realized, like, comparative to what I went through in the past, now things were easy for me. So it goes back to kind of that model of being trained. So Yusuf finds himself in prison. You know, some of the greatest Muslims came out of prison. Right? And in the 90s, in the early 2000s, our MSAs nationally had actually organized services for Muslims that were incarcerated. And of course, you know, Imam Jamil is incarcerated. And Malcolm X becomes Malcolm X in prison. Right? And Sayyidina Yusuf finds himself in prison. And you know, prison could have been an excuse to go crazy. But what do they say about him? Inna lanaraka la min al-muhsinin. The people are attracted to him because they say, there's good in you. You're a good person. Something about you is different. One of the qualities of a believer is tamyiz, meaning we have some type of fidelity, some type of integrity. We're not self-righteous jerks, right? That's a problem, right? Religion should never create a sense of authority. Religion should create a sense of appreciation and humility. And sincerity. So he's very sincere. They say to him, we see you as a good person, right? We see you as someone of integrity. So again, the seasons of life change, the excuse to lose it. He could have lost it with his brothers when he was in the well. He could have lost it with the lady. He could have said, you know what? I've been going through all this, and this lady, mashallah, man, that's just once, man. Who cares, right? I'm sorry to be offensive, but that's how most men are going to think, right? Get mad about it. I'm sorry. I didn't take gender studies at UC Davis. Forgive me, but I respect you. But he could have lost it. We don't need to deconstruct it that way. He goes into prison. He can be like, you know what? That's it, man. I'm going to run to show up in this joint. Narco. I'm going to narco this prison. Right? But instead, he uses it to encourage himself to be better. You know, the more difficulties we face, that means the greater capacity we have to hold it down. The Prophet was asked by people, who are those most beloved to God? He said, those tested the most. Another narration said, Inna abda salih, the righteous servant will be burned clean of bad qualities, like with tests, like gold and silver are burned. Meaning they're purified by it. They come out pure. Sallallahu alayhi wasallam. And we have to hurry because of time, but we know that the story continues, until ultimately he finds some success. And at the end of the story, he greets success. And this is the last quality really that we should have. as we fall into success, we should become more grateful. You know, I said some things about my life tonight. You might have been like, I can't believe he said that. Why not? Have we created a community to the point that we're so stigmatized, we can't be honest with each other? Like, you are beautiful people. I got a good view here, man. I get the Nor tan. You know what I'm saying? All that Nor come out of your hearts, right? But how can you be honest if your imams or teachers or servants can't be honest with you? But as we become more successful, now, I remember my teacher from West Africa. You know, his main teacher was his sister. His sister was a great scholar. She memorized the Quran in 14 different ways. And she was an Arabist. She was something else, man. She was a poet. And I remember he told me, he said, look, if you achieve notoriety, don't forget to keep it real. And I was like, what do you mean? Like, of course, like, look at all these rappers around me, man. They're like, they're real. I was a kid, you know what I'm saying? I didn't know. I was like, they're real. They keep it real. Like, they're honest. He's like, no. Don't allow your success to cause you to forget people. You know what I mean? You have to stay down. So we see Sayyidina Yusuf. How does he embrace promotion? One of the dangers of the academy, I worked at Harvard for a while. It's not in that long, weird, freaky bio that our brother read earlier, that I didn't even say that. I was like, you know, and he says about himself, right. And when I worked there at Harvard, I can go that way, in Boston, there was a time I started to feel kind of like full of myself, man. Because the academy can give you a real false sense of value. You know? You get kind of big. We should be happy. We should be proud. We should be grateful. We should feel like, as a Muslim, yeah, I can drop the mic if needed by the help of Allah. I can kill this and murder this paper, metaphorically, by the grace of Allah, subhanahu wa ta'ala. I can succeed as a professional. Yes, and own it and get it, but not forget where it came from. That's what happens to him, you know. When I memorized this surah, I was scared to read it because I always cry at the end. In Arabic, it's so beautiful. Innaka anta Yusuf. You know, his brothers are vulnerable, man. They did all this crap to him. Excuse my language. Like, look what they did to him. Like, if someone did that to me and I was Yusuf, I'd have been like, yeah, yeah, what's up now? Dig a hole. Deep one. And get to pit bulls. And the raw meat. Right, I could have just done some wicked stuff to them. But they, in the way they speak to him in Arabic, innaka anta Yusuf means like, they're extremely weak. They're almost shocked. They're overwhelmed by it. And he says, yep, and this is my akhi. And then he says, Allah has blessed me. Like, I know if it was me, I'd have been like, y'all remember what y'all did? Well, your boy killed it. And guess what? Ho. But Yusuf is like, yes, it's me by Allah's grace. And we see this in the Quran, how the prophets accept professional success is unparalleled. Prophet Isa is born a scholar. He's born like master rabbi from the 36 chambers. You know what I'm saying? Like, he's holding it down. He's no joke. And he comes out talking. I mean, you want to talk about having swag? Come on, as a baby, knowing all the rabbinic law? Like, what? Really? And you can talk? What's the first thing he says? Inni Abdullah. I'm a slave of Allah. That's the first thing he says. Look at Prophet Muhammad on the night of Isra wa Mi'raj, alayhi salam. He goes to the highest levels of heaven. When he gets there, he's with Jibreel, and he says, Jibreel, you go ahead. Jibreel's like, what? Well, huh? He's like, no, you gotta go. He's like, no, go ahead. He doesn't get it twisted. Fame doesn't twist him. He doesn't forget. He doesn't forget where he was. I made this mistake. When I converted, I had a friend, his name was Greasy G. he was a blood, 456 Pomona Piru. And we were really good friends, man. Like good friends in high school. And after I became Muslim, because Greasy G, you can tell by his name, is a little wild. He's a little greasy. And I'm talking about like WD-40 style, like really greasy. And I was like, I'm Muslim and you're Greasy G. I can't hang out with you anymore. And I cut him. Had nothing to do with him, just cut him off. Really out of a sense of arrogance. You know what I mean? Not out of a sense of concern for myself. I used that as an excuse. There was an interview, he's in prison now. There was an interview done with him by a guy from Berkeley who was doing this paper on me, probably wrote that bio. And no disrespect to Berkeley people. And in the paper, he found this guy. Like, I lost track of this brother. And he went to see him in a state prison in Oklahoma. And he asked him, like, do you know what happened to Will? And he was like, no, man, what happened? Is he alive? Like, I remember he became Muslim. Like, they just disappeared. And we were in high school. And, you know, he was doing well. But I heard, you know, something about him wearing red, white dresses. And, like, he's like, no, he's like, he's, you know, he's kind of, like, done something, you know, with his life. So then he told him who I was, right? In the most simple, humble terms, mashallah. And he showed him my Facebook page and stuff. And then he said, he started crying and he said, why did he leave me? You know, why did he leave? Why didn't he take me with him? And then the reporter was telling me this and he was like, yo, you need to call him, dude. Like, you know, reporters are not supposed to lose, or the guy is doing his research, you're not supposed to lose that human. You're supposed to stay a jerk, basically. And he was like, you need to call him, man, because this is not cool. I was like, just do your paper, dude. Right? But I got it twisted, and I forgot someone who is important, right? Not because of financial success, not because of professional success, but because of religion. What would be my excuse? So I'm saying to you, the last story of Yusuf is extremely powerful, that in the face of success, and we didn't have a chance to talk about, we'll touch on it in a second, he stays humble. He doesn't forget people, man. He doesn't forget the people who even did evil to him, and he practices grace to them. Now that takes us into the idea of how we balance, like, because piety doesn't mean not to have swagger. But I have a problem with that. I don't like that. You know, I remember I became Muslim, and I went into the mosque, and this brother was like, you know, like, this brother's like really quiet. He's like, if that's how he is, that's a human nature, that's your swagger. Swagger doesn't mean you have to be verbose. You know, like J.R. Smith, you guys love him. He's so cavalier now. Sorry, right? Or say Mark Sanchez. But, although the Jets got a nice defense, right? But Tom Brady, you know what I'm saying? But swagger is different. Like, some people are swaggerous through their silence and through their solace, through their piety, and through their ability to be very focused and calm. And some people are very emotional, right? And that's how they have swagger. But we see Sayyidina Yusuf in the middle of the chapter, he actually steps up and leads. He doesn't use piety as an excuse not to be successful. Piety is not an alibi not to be successful. He says, Hafizun Alim. He says, I am someone who can do this job properly. So our scholars actually says something very interesting. When you read in the books of fiqh, the Maliki Madhab in particular, we say that if somebody has the ability to be a mufti, I studied this in Dar Ifta, and when they're asked to do that job, and they say no, they're a sinner. And they say that, some Malikis say that, if you can recite the Quran properly and you are standing to pray and people ask you to lead the prayer and you say no and someone leads the prayer who cannot recite the Quran properly, your prayer is invalid because you should have acted on what you have as a professional quality. So the idea of balancing responsibility with sometimes the arrogance and the sense of self-worth and hubris and narcissism of the age, Islam kind of finds this balance where, yeah, I can do this. Alhamdulillah, I can do this because I've been qualified, I've done what I need to do. That's very different than me trying to be very verbose and own things. And that's why the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam in the hereafter, when people come to all of the prophets and ask them to intercede, they will say, no, 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 no. But when they come to the Prophet, you say, wa ana laha, I'm for it. So we didn't, honestly, like, it's an hour, we can't go through this whole chapter together, right? Maybe inshallah, I'm a neighbor, you're not far from me, it's a train ride away, you can all come down through Penn Station. No, I'm just joking. I could come here if you know, Imam Khalid will hook me up with some of those miles that he has packed away, all those frequent flyer miles that he got, and do the chapter, you know, page by page, verse by verse. But at least that we're able to take some of the major themes. Number one, we said, an intimate relationship with the Qur'an. The Prophet said, إِنَّ لِلَّهِ أَهْلِينَ. Allah has chosen friends. The chosen friends of Allah are the people of the Qur'an. Second thing we said are the rights of the Qur'an. We mentioned to act on it, to have fear and hope with it, to give regard to its stories and parables. And then lastly, to believe in its allegorical verses. And then we started the chapter. We said there's some themes that we want to take. The first theme was balancing the metaphysical with the physical. He has a dream. He has a support group. He has this powerful metaphysical experience. He has kind of an epiphany, but he still goes back to his father. The second thing we said is to be careful of shaitan. We mentioned the seven goals of shaitan: to make us disbelievers, to make us fall into major sins, minor sins, disliked, innovation, major sins, minor sins, the disliked, the permissible, and then just to straight up take us out. And that's why, by the way, in the masjid, what is the front of the mosque called? Mihrab. What does mihrab mean? From the word harb, the place of war. Because that's where you wage war on shaitan. Right? The third thing that we talked about is how difficulties in life come and go. We should have a strategy, but we should not allow the difficulties to move our hearts. It's hard. I don't do it. I'm not claiming I have that. Right? I'm up here to teach us to learn twice. You know what I'm saying? So don't think I'm saying this and I'm like, oh, I bet Suhaib to be killing. No, 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 no. Like everybody else, right? If I lose my daughter in IKEA, I'm going to lose my mind, right? I'm going to have that moment of, right? Every day I have one, right? So I'm saying we strive to, as best we can, balance the seasons of life with keeping our identity as being spiritually focused and spiritually in tune with our Lord. And we gave the beautiful statement of Imam Ali, karramallahu wajhah. And then the last thing that we touched on were how you find in the chapter someone who is not only tested with the externals through his family, and we talked about how family is anything but perfect, remember? So we should lower our expectations. Like, it's dhulm to marry someone and expect them to be what you want. It's a form of emotional abuse, man. Right? But we love, it's like that John Legend song, man. I love all of you. Like, I embrace it all. Right? Because that's really, when people ask me, can you help me find someone I can marry who I can love? No, I can help you find someone you can hate. And it's like, what do you mean? We could all love each other right now. I know I could go into a nightclub down the street and love 99% of the occupants in 35 seconds. Seriously, right? But I can't hate them all. What I mean by that is, if I can fight with you and keep it domestic, that means I love you. That means I really care about you. And that's why when couples come to me, like, we're ready to be married. How long have you met? Well, one of us swiped right. I mean, no, one of us, we met. I was like, swipe right? Ashabu yameen? You know, people on the right side? Yeah, I'll be watching y'all. All y'all laughing. Are incriminating yourself. You need a lawyer from NYU before this night's over. But they're like, yeah, I swipe right, she swipe right on Mender. And like, we want to get married. Really, how long have you known each other? About 2.5 weeks. Cool. Yeah, we met at Starbucks once and we watched Three Idiots. Should have been two idiots, so you are three idiots. And then I say, okay. And you know what? We never fight. People that are older are like, yeah. I say, you know what? When you fight, come back. Like when you can have a fight and then you're able to manage your emotions and manage that, then come back. You might be ready for marriage. Because you have to marry the person you don't like, in the sense of you don't like at times, but you manage to keep that commitment to that person without losing it, without going beyond normality. So we say Sayyidina Yusuf is tested internally, externally. And the last one is with his soul, right? And he's able to hold it down. And then again, he goes through difficulties. Imam Shafi said, no one can become a scholar unless they were debased. I used to wonder, I read that in Azhar. I was in Azhar Masjid. I read that. I was like, I'm not trying to be debased, dude. Right? But then I understood what he meant is that you can appreciate others through your own becoming. Because Islam is a process. It's not an event. And then the last thing we talked about is how to deal with really professional success. Right? And oftentimes the academy, I've been there. Even when I came back from Egypt, you know, one time I was giving a lecture in California. I thought I had the red hat and everything on. I was holding it down. And this kid that I used to teach before I left to Egypt, this is my boy, right? I used to teach this young man. He came to me, he was like, Imam, I got to talk to you. It's code red. I was like, really? What happened? You swipe right? He was like, no, you make no freaking sense now. What happened to you? You used to be normal. And now you're like the people that we wanted you to replace. And I was like, exactly. I was like, we need to go outside for a minute, have a conversation. And then I became like Sheikh. I was like, he doesn't have traditional scholarship, and he doesn't have adab with the ulama, and praising myself and not even realizing I'm so drunk in my own hubris, right? So then I go to his youth director. I'm like, you have this kid, faqid al-adab, adim al-mulkh, right? You know, Egyptians, like, when we go hard, man. Egyptians have more bars than Hershey's. Like, they could just eviscerate you. So I like eviscerated this poor child, right? And then this youth director who's my friend, he grabs, he's like, dude, you need to freaking wake up, man. And I was like, what? He's like, you're not Suhaib, man. You got a problem. He's like, you're full of yourself, bro. Why do you dress like this? And I was like, I don't know. Because he's like, yeah, I know why. Because you think clothes make you. He's like, clothes don't make you. Right? It's good. You need people around you. That support group, we said earlier, the support group is not people who just tell you you're doing great. Like I said, the person that you should marry is the person that you can hate. The person that you should be friends with is the person that can say things you don't like to hear sometimes. Because that's what it means to be sidq, means to be a sadiq. I'm truthful to you in every situation. That's why Yusuf is called what? Yusuf what? A sadiq. Because in every context, he's truthful to God. Right? He doesn't use the context as an excuse to slip. Right? Just like us. We work out hard. We use it as an excuse to eat pizza. You know, well, I worked out real hard last night. Like, I can eat what I want. Same thing. Well, you know, I was obeying Allah for like a day. So tonight, I'm making rain. Right? Like, how does that work? It doesn't work that way. Right? So then I complained to him about the kid. And he said, actually, man, the kid is trying to tell you something because he trusts you. You should listen to him. Right? So sometimes we get lost in our own professional success. Even religion. Religion takes a lot of people out of who they should be, right? And that's why oftentimes when you find like the Muslim who quote unquote is not the most practicing, you find like spiritual energy from them that you don't find in the practicing community. You find sincerity in them that you don't find in the practicing community, because the practice became a fashion, not an intimacy. So the last thing we learn about him is how he embraces success. And he does so with humility. So we'll stop here, inshallah. We'll take about 25 seconds for questions. I want to go to the parade, man. No, I'm just joking. I'm trying to get some candy, dude. And whatever questions or comments or reflections, I want to encourage you to share also some of your thoughts. Please feel free to do so. Yes, ma'am. Come Sam talk about it. Did I ever call a friend in prison? I sent him a letter. I thought I should write him. I thought writing would be more appropriate. So we slowly reestablished a relationship. May Allah yahdi, inshallah. Yes, sir. Are you just dipping out? He's like, Gotcha. Yeah, I'm welcome. As soon as possible. I'm just joking. I'll go get some caramel candy, you know what I'm saying? No, I might drive back to D.C., so I'm debating. But take your time, don't worry. Yes, ma'am. I'm so sorry, I can't hear you. Yeah, the name of this translation is The Study of Quran, A New Translation and Commentary. It is on Amazon. You can pre-order it. It's really mashallah. You know, I read Quran in Arabic. I haven't read the Quran in English for a long time, but this is one of the first ones I picked up in English, and I was like, the only thing I don't like is some of the thee and thou. Like, I wish they would change that. I have a problem with that language because of my children. But overall, mashallah, it's very nice. Free of any ideological issues. Like, sometimes you read English translation, you can tell, like, that person's school of thinking. Like, I shouldn't be able to feel that when I'm reading the Book of God. Right? It should be ecumenical as possible. So this one, it comes across as just really the meaning is what was intended. Yes, ma'am. Hey, how you doing? Spent some years at the Ella Collins Institute, first year, right? See? I'll be remembering people. Mashallah. Actually, I'm not sure if it's her, but it's her. It's you, right? I go, phew, okay, thank God. That's a great question, and that's a very powerful question. I've had this happen to me. She's saying, when do you realize that maybe someone who you trust and you've allowed into that circle, right? That circle needs to be very controlled, by the way. You know what I mean by that circle? The people who can really, like the guy who grabbed me and said, like, you lost your mind, right? I keep that circle very tight. In fact, that circle for me are people that I converted with. Because they don't care about Suhaib Webb. The heck's that? They remember me for who I really am, right? Because who I was is who I am. I can't run from myself. But I've been in a situation. When I started learning Arabic, there was a person who I let into the inner circle. And I started to speak Arabic in Oklahoma. I learned Arabic in Oklahoma. You know, converts in the 90s, we just learned Arabic. It's the 90s. Like, khutbahs were in Arabic. Like, there were conferences like Arabic, لِنَاتِقِينَ بِالْعَرَبِيَّةِ فَقَطْ. Like, it was written, like, Arabic speakers only. And you want to go to the conference, so you learn Arabic, right? It's kind of a strange treadmill moment. So as I started to speak Arabic, of course, in the beginning, you know, I was like, ismi jitu wakad suhebun, right? You know, I speak Arabic, right? Because I was an adult trying to learn a language that the society doesn't speak. And I was watching a lot of Iftahu Simsim, you know, like cartoons and stuff. And there was this brother, he would come to me, he was like, أعتقد أنك لا تستطيع أن تتحدث لغتنا أبدا. Like, he would come to me, he was Arab, and he would say, you know, I don't think you'll ever be able to speak Arabic. And I was like, yeah, exactly. So I was like, in the beginning, and now I was memorizing Quran, right? And he's like, وَكَذَٰرِكَ يَعْنِي اللَّهُ سُبْحَانَهُ وَتَعَالَىٰ مَا يَأْمُرَكَ أَنْ تَحْفَظْ كِتَابَهُ. Like, Allah didn't order you to memorize his book. And I was like, I'm a white dude from Oklahoma. Like, if I learn Arabic and memorize Quran, like, I might be able to help my friend Greasy G. You know, like, why would you tell me? And that started happening when I was very young. I was 20, 21 years old. And it, like, hurt me when I realized this dude's jealous. He's like a hater, right? So I cut him out. So we have a very simple principle in Islam. Advice should be able to bring about something good. Like, even if it means leaving something, it's going to bring you closer to Allah. But advice that becomes abusive or authoritarian. And that's why one of the conditions of the community that I work in is like no emotional abuse will be tolerated. In the name of religion, there's no emotional abuse. You know what I'm saying? If a Shia brother wants to pray that way, you have a right to go up to him and like just eviscerate that person. You don't have to agree with that, but you don't have to eviscerate that person. Sister, we had a sister walk into a mosque in Boston one time without, you've been to that mosque, without hijab on. And I was walking out of my office, and this dude is throwing a hijab on her head, like from 10 feet away. And it's the land of Tom Brady. Unlike Mark Sanchez, you can hit the target in New England. He hit her, and she started crying. So then I was like, enough. I became Oklahoma white guy. Enough is enough, right? And I went up there, and I was like, just please come with me. And she grabbed my hand. And people in the mosque were like, ooh, she grabbed his hand. I was like, man, the girl is crying. Like, it's not like, you know what I mean? She's crying. Like, she's emotionally hurt, you know? So I went to the office. I thought she was a convert. I convert profiled her. And then she was like, Shlona, kam sakhla bakhar, saktayab. She was a Khaliji. She was from Saudiya. And she was like, yeah, imamana. She's like, this is the first day I've come to a mosque since I came to America. My grandfather died 2 hours ago. So I was in class, I got a text, my grandfather died. The first place I knew to go was to Allah. She's like, I just can't, I didn't even know. She's like, I'm so out there, I didn't even know it was Jummah, man. She's like, I know I'm not good. She starts to cry, I know I'm not good. Like, ana mush saliha, wa mush arafa kalam da. And then she's like, but I know I can go to Allah. And I'm like, man, this woman is like so much more pious than I am. Like, I don't have those kind of emotional currents, and I'm here to give the khutbah. Like, I'm like, you know, would you mind, like, yo, put a kufi on? It's like, you know, I ain't gonna tell nobody. Point is that kind of advice, and when I went to talk to the person, like, why did you horseshoe the hijab? You know what I'm saying? He's like, well, I wanted to help her. I wanted to bring her closer to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. I'm like, so as a man throwing clothing on a woman in 2013 in liberal bastion New England, you didn't think about what that means to that woman? And he was like, yeah, it means she's going to be drawn nearer to Allah. I was like, God, I don't care, really. So when people start to hurt us, we should pull away from them. No matter how close they are, like his brothers. What does his father say to him? Stay away from them. Don't tell them the good news. And it hurts, man. It's harsh, man. It's tough. My own brother disinvited me to his wedding. I flew to Oklahoma last year to surprise him for his wedding. Because I'm trying to do the Muslim thing where you fix it. You bring like some nice watches and stuff. You hook up the girl, you know what I'm saying? Crystal, the whole nine, whatever, Oklahoma. Porcelain and stuff like that. Tupperware. And I get there, and my mother starts crying, and she's like, I'm sorry to tell you, but your brother disinvited you because of your fame as a Muslim preacher. So you ain't alone in this. And then if I talk to him, he's like, well, you know, maybe you should quit your job. I'm like, why don't you quit your job, bro? Like, what the heck, quit my job, right? So that's the situation where I told my mom, I was like, look, I love my brother. If he needs help financially, I got his back. But I ain't got nothing to do with him no more. Right? Because you got to learn. Oh, you ain't asked my mother to tell me this information? My mother's 70 years old, man. So, and I know about what you're saying. Cut that off. Give it time. You got to go back and visit every once in a while. But nobody should be destroying your life saying they love you. No husband, no wife, no brother, no father, no mother, man. And I have a problem with this. We destroy people in our community sometimes. In the name of religion, the most gracious, the most merciful, we destroy people. Like, really, the most righteous Muslim I ever met. You know where I met him? In a hookah bar. Wallahi. My friend called me. I have a story. Just don't worry. Everybody's like, ooh. See, why y'all gotta judge me? Why are you judging me? No, seriously. Outside of the Starbucks and the Fakhir, I have a friend who I became Muslim with who is not Mr. Pious. Mr. Pius happens to be Mr. Hookah. When I need to see him, right, because we do a lot of business ventures together, I have to unfortunately find him in hookah lounges like, you know, Cleopatra, Umm Kulthum. You know, I know all these places. I met a Muslim convert who doesn't speak Arabic but can say every flavor of tobacco in Arabic. Right. So I went, I met him, we were talking, right? And then there was a guy who was in there smoking, and he said to me, "Are you who I think you are?" I said, "Hey, look, look, the only thing I got here is water, man. I'm good." Although, you know. So, but then he started telling me about his life and his struggles. And it was, I was brought to tears in the hookah lounge, man. Because he was just like, he wasn't infected with that sickness we have of needing to destroy people. He was still sincere. You know what I mean? So we should pray for you. One of the things we do in D.C., we have community prayer where we, instead of someone standing in front of us and praying for us who doesn't know us, we ask people, like, what do you need us to pray for? And people raise their hand, like, we had a brother, he's like, my son got shot last night. And people in the audience who are Muslims are like, we didn't even know. Like, how can I be your brother? I don't even know your son got shot. His sister raised her hand. You know, the gentrification, I don't know about Harlem, but D.C., basically, they just pour Clorox on D.C. It's no longer Chocolate City. They call it Latte City. Like, seriously, it happened so fast. The projects in front of my house are now gone that those, like, the guys I used to know across the projects from me, their family comes to visit them, and they ask me, like, Big Will. They call me Big Will. They call me Imam. They're like, where are they? I'm like, you didn't hear they closed the projects? They're like, we didn't even know. Like, this is how fast they closed the projects. So it's creating a tremendous stress on communities. And the sister raised her hand, and she's like, I can't pay my rent tomorrow, man. And people were like, but we were just with you yesterday, and, like, we went to this conference, and, like, you don't really know people till you hear, like, what you should pray for them about. It's like, for you, man, may Allah give you thabat, because I know that situation, man. You know, it's times I prayed for you when I was on Umrah, after we talked in the masjid, right? I'm telling you that so that you know, like, you're not alone, man. Sometimes it's hard, right? So may Allah strengthen you, inshallah. Any other questions before I get emotional? Yes, ma'am. Come on, talk. That's a good question. So she's saying in Surah Yousuf, there's a part where Yaqub says, Udkhulu abwab mutafarriqa. Right? Sayyidina Yaqub says to his sons, after they've gone to see Yusuf, then Yusuf tricks them and they go back to their father. They're bringing back their brother. They lose their brother. They go back again. Then he's like, when you go back again, Udkhulu abwab mutafarriqa. Not because of hasad, not because of envy and jealousy, but because of strategy. Right? Enter different doors so people won't notice you. If you go together as a group, you'll be noticed, but you need to break it in there. Like, you need to handle this without a lot of people noticing what's happening. Not because of Ayn and Hasid, he was worried people would arrest him or take them. So he doesn't want to lose any more kids. Understand what I'm trying to say? So one of our teachers, we asked him about the political system in America. He's like, you know, there needs to be Muslim Republicans. I was like, what? Whatever, bump that dog. He's like, Udkhulu abwa mutafarriqa, go through different doors. And then he said, you learn from the story of Yusuf that an empty chair can't speak for you. Right? So it's more about participating. So we should think about in America, if we're going to enter through the doors of the society in different ways, we've already entered, right? Right? I mean, you're in New York City. Are you aware of, like, hip-hop's marriage with Islam in this city? And how, like, we fail to take, like, really respect that? Like, the woman who puts on the most, I would say, organic, gluten-free, real hip-hop shows in New York City is, you know, Fabio's wife. You know, Mr. Fabulous is a Puerto Rican convert from the Bronx who was part of the Rock Steady crew in the 80s. His wife, Christy, was featured in the New York Times. You know, she brings together, like, DJ Red Alert and KRS, and Public Enemy, and all these incredible old, massive giants, Grandmaster Caz and all the Q-Tip. That's a Muslim woman that organized it in hijab. She dakharat bab mutafarraq. She's gone through a different door, right? There's no reason why Muslims in New York ain't turning New York out, right? Just because of the amount of talent you have and the differences that you bring to the table. In Boston, a beautiful, incredibly regal black woman walked in my office. She's like, Imam, I need you to endorse me for mayor. I said, what? My father's a PhD in American history, so I'm using, guess what, Dad, today, you know what I'm saying? He was pumped, right? And I was like, well, can I ask you why? She said, and she had these two guys with her in these really weird suits. But the point I'm trying to say, I was scared. I was worried. She said to me, I need to talk to you. I want you to endorse me. And I said, why? She said, Imam, are you aware of the diversity of your community? I was like, yeah. I mean, she's, are you aware of how many ethnicities you have in your mosque? I was like, no. She's like, I had these two people, they did a study of your community, and we have discovered that you have 91 ethnicities in your mosque. Do you know what that means? I say, yeah, headache. That's what that means. Iftar is a monster. You know, these people want achar, these people want pot roast and mashed potatoes. And these people want trainers, they want sweet potatoes. It's a mess. She said to me, Imam, that means power. So, diversity of going through different doors, that's why we should not try to standardize religion in our community. We should embrace the saint and the sinner. Understand that people have different roles to play. Whether it's our brother Ismail, the calligrapher, you know, going to take pictures of Big Sean, hey, that's his role, man. That's what he does. If it's one of our sisters holding it down, you know, in one of the finance district areas, holding it down. One of our sisters fighting gentrification in Harlem, hey, hold it down. So one of our brothers who's a sheikh and imam, hold it down. One of our sisters who's a sheikh and imam, hold it down. If it's Imam Khadid selling meat to people, hold it down, right? Want my discount, I want my brisket tonight, brah. But I'm saying that's udkhulu abwab mutafarriqa. What our community has tried to do is standardize, in the face of modernity, standardize how religion is practiced and create this kind of monolithic, you know, and that's not realistic. Udkhulu abwab mutafarriqa. Any other questions? Yes, ma'am. Yeah, I mean, that happened to me after the Boston bombing, right? You know, there were things that people said I said I didn't even say. And then people ran with it like, imagine as a convert, man, someone calls you like a non-Muslim, man. Like all you struggled for as a convert to hear that, you know what I mean? To be abused. And, you know, I came out of the Boston bombing almost like, yo, I don't trust the community no more, man. You know what I mean? Like, I don't even, if I wasn't an imam, I told sisters and brothers today, like, if I wasn't an imam, I wouldn't go to the masjid, right? At that time. I go for Allah, alhamdulillah, but I'm saying the social piece. And it took me, you know, some time. Actually, I had to pull out of institutions and just be independent. Now, to really recover, man, from some of the experiences that I've had in institutions and organizations. And that's not to say all institutions and organizations are bad, right? They're not. Imam Siraj, great community. Khalid here. Has some great communities in California. Boston's a great community. D.C. TNIC is a cool masjid. But when we are, one of the worst things we can do is really question a person's faith. And that's why in all the books of creed, we are not allowed to question a person's faith. You know, the Prophet never said anyone is a kafir amongst the Sahabi, and he never said that anyone is a person of taqwa. He left it to Allah. But the assumption is everybody's good, right? The assumption is people are good. Everybody got issues, right? Some of us, Allah hid our issues. Others, our issues may be more apparent. You know what I'm saying? So I would encourage for a person that's gone through, they call it now post-traumatic stress religion syndrome or something like that, is that they should find a community that embraces them, accepts them, and helps them heal, man. Because what broke us is what heals us. In Oklahoma, my grandma used to say, the best remedy for the snake bite is the snake venom. So sometimes it's finding that community that can model the opposite of what we experienced. The second thing is, listen, nobody has the right to tell you how valuable you are. Never give anybody that control over your life. I don't care who it is, because that's just too much authority to give to people. People love to live vicariously through others. Sense of power, right? So I validate myself through the community naturally, because I'm part and parcel of a community that I'm responsible, that I live with, and they live with me. But at the same time, like, I have to be, Allah says, وَلَا تَزِرُ وَزِرَةٌ وَزِرَ أُخْرَ. I'm responsible for myself. So I would encourage, and then I would say contact, like someone like a chaplain, like Imam Khalid, someone that has more of a pastoral background than say a clerical background. Right. May Allah help you, inshallah. Any other questions? If not, barakallahu fikum wa jazakumullahu khairan. It's always great to be in New York City. Assalamu alaikum wa rahmatullah.